Here is the new iPad Pro 5th Gen 12.9 inch. Compared with the 4th Gen, here are the differences. A mini LED screen that promises deeper black levels with higher peak and sustained brightness. An improved processor called the M1 that is identical to the one in the MacBook Pro 13, Air, Mac Mini, and iMac 24. Thunderbolt USB-C, enabled by the new M1 chip that boasts faster data transfer rates. A new front-facing camera that allows for center stage. Finally, 5G and sub-6 capabilities if your country actually has 5G. To set the two sizes apart, Apple has only included the new Liquid Retina XDR display in the 12.9-inch model and separated these two apart other than just screen size. The 11-inch has an identical screen as previous iPad Pros, but still gets all the other upgrades. The number of LEDs don't really matter. It's the dimming zones that dictate how finely the backlight can be controlled. Previous iPad, one dimming zone, the backlight is either completely on or off. This causes backlight bleed and make areas that are supposed to be black to actually look dark gray as light still seeps through the screen filter like a curtain that's not quite thick enough. This new iPad, 59x44 grid dimming zone, each consisting of 4 mini LEDs. The backlight LED for each zone can be individually turned off for darker blacks. However, if any part of the area needs to be lit, the whole dimming zone is activated. This gives rise to bloom in certain scenarios, like a bright object on a dark background. Drawing white dots on the black canvas show the square zone is lit and light seeping into the surrounding area. I call this masterpiece Starry Night. The object has a grey halo and is most obvious when looking from a diagonal corner. The effect is reduced when looking straight on, which is the position I hope you're viewing any screen from. There are three advertised brightness levels, 600, 1000, and 1600 nits. 1000 nit is full brightness only when viewing HDR content, like on YouTube or Netflix when the HDR or Dolby Vision option is explicitly stated. Safari does not support HDR YouTube. 1600 nit peak brightness is for extremely bright spots in the HDR content. There's a noticeable difference when viewing HDR videos on this new one. Brights are brighter, darks are darker. 600 nit is still the typical operating brightness, basically everything else. Web browsing, regular apps, almost all YouTube videos are not HDR, so your screen will still be capped at 600 nits, which is just as bright as previous iPad Pros. So to fully enjoy the screen, you should use it in the dark room to fully appreciate the deep blacks. Then, watch a video, of which only a tiny portion of that is HDR, so you get 1000 nits. At that point, I asked myself, am I just finding scenarios to justify this new mini LED screen if it'll just behave like a normal iPad for everyday tasks? So don't expect your PDF or photos to suddenly look so much better. It's just a state of the mind. The dimensions of the 11 has not changed. The 12.9-inch is just 0.5mm thicker than its predecessor due to the new screen, and it led some people to believe that it won't fit in the existing Magic Keyboard. Others have tested it, yes it'll fit, onto the cameras. The new higher megapixel front-facing camera is now in ultrawide too. This enables a feature that Apple calls center stage, where it detects the subject and does a digital crop to center the person in the frame. It will zoom out when it detects multiple faces. Using the camera app reveals the full ultrawide with heavy distortion in the corners, but it will default to the crop view to be consistent with older iPads. To enable the feature, go to Settings and enable Center Stage for each individual application. It works on almost all major video conferencing applications like FaceTime, Zoom, Discord, Telegram, Instagram Live, etc. So how much off-center can you be? A cone of 120 degrees in the front of the camera, sitting directly in front of the desk, roughly half arm's length in both directions with the default tilt angle. Sitting slightly further back, one arm's length, you can do large gestures and pace back and forth to add some movement into the presentation. Quality isn't the front-facing camera's main focus since it'll only be used for video calls, so I'll give it a pass. One complaint is still the location of the camera at the top of the screen. All the accessories make the iPad stand in landscape mode, which is the default video call position. So just put it on the right hand side like Samsung Tab S7. The sensor of the back camera is identical to the old ones. It's inferior to the iPhone, and if you are using this device to primarily take photos, then you deserve to be publicly shamed. I had to endure some humiliation to bring you these comparison images with the iPad. Daytime shots are fine. It better be, since budget $200 phones can also take decent photos. There's no night mode on the iPad, so photos at night naturally look really bad. It's just another software feature that Apple could include, but won't, because my product segmentation. Video? Yeah, it's here if you want. No OIS. Another gimp. Just don't even think about taking videos at night. It can't even handle photos. The main purpose of the iPad cam is to take photos of documents and slides. Yes, I'm reading from the left. This does the job fine, but inclusion of an ultrawide was always puzzling. You ain't doing no landscape photography, or I hope at least you aren't. I long for a telephoto, which will come in handy for classroom scenarios where I'm trying to snap whiteboard notes or the projector from back of the lecture hall. The main shooter does not take photos of faraway objects at an adequate quality, and I feel a telephoto will be much more beneficial for an iPad's primary use case. The A12X was already overkill for the iPad back in 2018, and this makes the M1 completely unnecessary for iPadOS. If you're doing actual work, you'd use macOS or some Windows-based device. Most professional applications that are on the iPad are just cut down versions of the desktop counterparts with lousy mouse and keyboard support. There's no Premiere Pro, no Final Cut, I can't run Cinebench on it, there's no calculator app, so what's the point of putting a desktop class chip when I can't run desktop class applications on this sucker? So wait till 7 June. The WWDC will shed some light on Apple's plans for the new iPad Pro. It still has 1 to 8 gigs of base storage and goes up to 2 terabytes. 8 gigs of RAM by default and 16 paired automatically with the 1 and 2TB options. Of course, Apple charges exorbitant amounts of money for each storage tier, and I only recommend the base storage. You can always purchase an external USB-C storage device and then save your data there. It's much cheaper than buying a higher storage tier. Some applications do allow you to take advantage of more RAM. That's if the developers actually update their apps for this new iPad. Procreate with identical settings, this one 8 gigs, 25 layers, 2018 model, 4 gigs, 55 layers. How can the old one with half the RAM have double the layers? It's revealed that all M1 iPad Pros have 5.1 gig RAM limitation for some applications. Procreate updated app on 28 May to allow for more layers. This RAM issue should be resolved in the new iPadOS 15 update that I demand to be announced during WWDC later. Another app, Adobe Rush, identical timeline. 4x 4K clips with color profiles applied render at 1080p 30fps, both 39 second render time. Then what good is this M1 if the 3-year-old A12Z is just gonna be as fast? Yes, I'm sure there are applications that will run faster with the M1, but it is still limited by the iPad software. The USB-C is now Thunderbolt equipped, but still with identical charging speeds. Do you have a Pro Display XDR? What about a Thunderbolt equipped device? Most likely no. Even I found it difficult to saturate the regular USB-C speed. Connecting this Dell 4K USB-C monitor only mirrors a screen with black bars on the side. The same goes for the $5,000 Pro Display XDR. A handful of apps like Adobe Rush or LumaFusion will use the second screen to a limited extent. But wouldn't you want to use the superior iPad screen that can display HDR as the preview window and take advantage of the larger real estate of the connected screen for your timeline instead? In Adobe Rush, the preview will drop quality when you're trying to play back the footage. So what's the point of connecting a high resolution screen when it won't use it at full quality? Apple really needs to improve the compatibility with external monitors because this feature right now is not useful at all. It's sad to see there's still no screen extension for the iPad, and it's a feature reserved for macOS. just scraped together some data from other reviewers for Geekbench scores. The same M1 in the MacBook Air, Pro, iMac will score higher but not by much. Here it is compared to previous gen iPad Pros and the latest iPad Air with the A14 chip. I don't have much time, so let's get on with it. A long graphics workload to simulate games. I'll test this with 3D Mark Wildlife Extreme. It starts off strong at 5K but drops to 3.4 in the end. Just like all passively cooled devices, system performance is dependent on temperature and surroundings. Worst case, using a hot sun. Best case, using a walk-in freezer. Its average sustained performance is better than last year's A12X and the A14 in the iPad Air. I'm throwing the A13 in the iPhone 11 and S865 in the Samsung Galaxy Tab S7, the Android equivalent of the iPad Pro for comparison as well. The A14 in the Air is adequate for iPad and A12X in the 2018 is still overkill. Compared to older models, you're not getting anything revolutionary by upgrading. Identical design chassis, supports the same peripherals, and still has a kick-ass processor. The 2018 is still the device I recommend, and you can get one used for a decent price since it's 3 years old now. For the 12.9 model, the lack of HDR content means the screen will perform the same as the old model most of the time with the added benefit of darker blacks. This makes it a tough sell for people who are expecting to be blown away by the new Liquid Retina XDR display, only to find out that it doesn't look that much different from the previous iPad. You should try it out in the store yourself. For most people, I still recommend the iPad Air. The main difference will be the lack of ProMotion and the cut-down processor. Others who would like to get this exclusive feature and a larger size must go for the 12.9-inch sadly. It still shares many of the features with the Pro, like identical chassis, same peripherals, and in my opinion, the superior way to unlock your device in this day and age, fingerprint. For students, you will not use this iPad Pro to its full potential by writing notes and PDF documents. You will also not be requiring the graphical horsepower unless you're someone who games frequently on the iPad. The iPad Air will be a better choice for most students and is much cheaper than the Pro. This is not a laptop. No matter how many times Apple tells you, the iPad cannot replace a laptop. There are many things that iPadOS still cannot do. Whether I like it or not, I paid for this in full and will be using it for the next half decade. My initial impressions are somewhat negative because it does what the 2018 model can already do and the used one costs half as much. The iPad Air will be more suited for my use case as a student. My initial reactions for the announced specs were of joy. Wow, new screen, desktop class M1 processor, Thunderbolt 4, price stay the same. Wow, look at these specs, they are great on paper but it's not actually useful as shown in the review. This iPad is a waste of potential and we need to wait to WWDC on 7 June to see if Apple will finally beef up the software and make the iPad Pro great again. It's all speculation once again, don't buy that product for what it could be, buy it for what it is now. Finally, here are top 10 things to do when you get the new iPad Pro. Number 10, full refund. Thanks for watching.